Have you ever seen the movie The Lion King? If you have, you've probably seen this scene. That I saw. But is it true? Do you hear their lyrics? It's a circle of life that moves you through despair and hope, through faith and love, till you find your place on the path unwinding in the circle of life. But does it work? Does the circle of life move you through despair and hope? Does it move you through faith and love? No, not really. The circle of life lies. The Catholic philosopher Peter Grieve tells a story about a family that he knew, neighbors of his, and this couple had a 7-year-old son, and the son's 3-year-old cousin died tragically. And since this couple didn't believe in God or an afterlife, they explained the cousin's death to their son with the circle of life. They said something like this. They said, "Son, you know, your cousin has gone to the earth from where we all come, because death is part of the natural cycle of life. And so now your cousin is fertilizing the earth. And in the spring, when the flowers bloom, your cousin will be fertilizing those flowers." Now, how did the son react? He screamed, "I don't want him to be fertilizer!" And then he ran away. I don't think that's such a strange reaction. This past week, I saw a photograph that haunts me still. It was a beautiful young girl was lying in a casket, 4 years old. She had a wreath of flowers around her head, and her father was kneeling down beside her, touching her head. She, the daughter, had been out taking a walk with her mother, and a piece of shrapnel from another senseless attack in the senseless war in Ukraine had killed her and put her mother at death's door. Now, do you think that the circle of life is going to move that dad through despair and hope? Is it going to move him through faith and love? Is the thought that his daughter is fertilizer pushing up the daisies going to give him comfort and strength? I don't think so. I mean, does it give you comfort and strength? If it doesn't, I'll tell you why. The circle of life lies. It's not true, not true for you, not true for anyone. But once you know what is true, you have a hope, a strength, a comfort that gets you through anything. Now, what is this hope? In these words, God tells you. So let's listen and hear what God has to say. We're reading from a letter that Paul wrote to a church in Thessalonica. And I invite you to hear the words as we begin reading them in the 4th chapter of that letter. Paul writes, "But we do not want you to be uninformed, brothers and sisters, about those who have died, so you may not grieve as others do who have no hope. For since we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so, through Jesus, God will bring with him those who have died. For this we declare to you by the word of the Lord, that we who are alive, who are left unto the coming of the Lord, will by no means precede those who have died. For the Lord himself, with a cry of command, with the archangel's call, and with the sound of God's trumpet, will descend from heaven, and the dead in Christ will rise first. Then we who are alive, who are left, will be caught up in the clouds together with them to meet the Lord in the air. And so we will be with the Lord forever. Therefore, encourage one another with these words." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. So how do you deal with death? You don't deal with death by denying the reality of it. You deal with death by declaring this. You declare death does not have the last word. Now, why doesn't it? Because Jesus does. Jesus has the last word. Jesus' love does. And against that love, not even death can stand. But before you can see the power and truth of that declaration, you need to see how the other ways of dealing with death simply don't work. You see, in a world, if you don't believe in an afterlife, a life that continues out of after death, how do you deal with it? You either, essentially, in both cases, you live in denial. You deny the reality of it. And you do that either by deadening yourself to death, or by rationalizing your way out of it. Now, deadening yourself to death has a pretty noble history. It goes back to the very beginning, to works as ancient as those of the Greeks. In a famous work called the Iliad, the poet Homer tells the story of another senseless war, the war over the city of Troy. And in that war, Priam, the king of Troy, loses his beloved son Hector in battle at the hands of Achilles, the Greek warrior. Priam decides that he is going to go to the enemy camp. He goes to the very tent of Achilles to get his boy's body back. And in a stunning scene, Priam and Achilles, who is also dealing with his own deep loss, they weep together. They mourn together. But they do not grieve for long, because Achilles says this to Priam: "For all our grief, we will hide our sorrows in our hearts, for weeping will not avail us." And then he goes on to say something like, "Well, the gods really don't care about us anyway, so we may as well just suck it up and move on." And then Achilles ends his words to Priam, whose son he had killed, with these words. He says, "Bear up. Don't give in to angry grief. Nothing will come of sorrowing for your son, nor will you raise him up before you die." Now, what is Achilles telling Priam? He is saying, shut your grief down. But you can't do that. You can't deaden yourself to the grief, to the pain. You can't shut it down. Anyone who is grieved can tell you that. Those emotions, they have a life of their own. If you deaden the grief, you deaden yourself. And you're not supposed to deaden those emotions. When you lose someone, You have got to grieve. You know, my mom died at 91. She had a good life. But not a day goes by that I do not miss her presence this side of heaven. You know, they used to talk about grief resolution before they realized that was the wrong word. Now they call it grief reconciliation. Why? You don't ever resolve your grief. You reconcile yourself to it. You learn to live with it. But that grief, it never goes away completely. Nor should it. To deaden yourself to grief is to deaden yourself to reality, is simply to deny reality. To deny reality of what death is, how awful it is, no matter at what age it happens. Now, at least deadening yourself to death acknowledges that something is there. I mean, Priam and Achilles do weep, at least a bit. But the other way you can deal with grief outside of a belief in the afterlife is to rationalize it. The whole circle of life deal. And in theory, it does make some sense. You live, you die, you become fertilizer and push up the daisies. But here's the problem. No one ever, no human being ever, has ever seen death as natural like that. Let me ask you a question. Does a fish get wet? No, not in the way that you do when you jump in the pool. For a fish, water is simply what is. It's natural. It's normal. It's simply for us like the air you breathe. But no human being feels that way about death. No one in their gut sees death as simply something normal and natural like the air you breathe. If anything, you see death as an enemy, just an enemy you cannot escape. I remember someone once said to me, you know, we all live on a limited lease and we're subject to immediate eviction. Kind of sobering. Whew. But does that feel natural? I mean, why do you call death the grim reaper? Does that sound like something natural to you? Death doesn't feel natural. Death feels wrong. When I was in my 30s, I experienced someone my own age for the first time who had died. He was a classmate of mine in high school. I didn't know Giovanni Agnelli well. We didn't travel in the same crowds. He was a member of the family that owns Fiat, one of the richest families in the world, and my family did not travel in that circle. But even from a distance, I remember seeing Giovanni's kindness, his exuberance, his charisma. He was no spoiled rich kid. He was something special. So when my friend called me and said, "Did you hear that Giovanni died?" I couldn't believe it. He said, "No, check today's New York Times. I'm telling you the truth." And there it was in black and white. Giovanni Agnelli, who at that time was the head of Vespa, the scooter company, had died at the age of 33 from non-Hodgkin's lymphoma. He left behind a wife that he had married just over a year before. He had a baby daughter who was but 3 months old. And he was gone. And that little girl would never, ever know her father, at least this side of heaven. You know, and that doesn't feel natural to me. It just feels wrong. No one should die in their 30s. But, you know, more than that, don't you sense that death isn't something that makes sense that much more in your 90s either? I mean, does it feel wrong to lose people you love? Does it feel unjust for you to lose strength and vitality as you age, just as you are beginning to figure it all out? Why do doctors and nurses fight disease? Why did the whole world shut down for COVID? Why has avoiding death become maybe our favorite national pastime? Right? You know, eat healthy, vitamins, exercise. Why? Because nobody wants to die. No one wants that elephant in the room. And no matter how you might rationalize it, you sense that death, that elephant, is not supposed to be there at all. Death isn't normal. Death isn't natural. It's an elephant in the room. It's an intruder. It's an enemy. And you want to kick it out. Rationalizing it as something natural, as the circle of life, denies that reality. The reality every human being feels about death. And why do you feel that? It's because it's true. Death is an enemy. Just a defeated one. So how do you deal with death if you don't deaden yourself to it or try to rationalize it away? In these words, here God tells you, you deal with the death by declaring that death does not have the last word. Jesus does. His love does. Now, declaring that death does not have the last word does not mean denying death's reality or its power or its pain. I mean, you see how Paul begins this passage. He says, we do not want you to be uninformed, brothers and sisters, about those who have died so that you may not grieve as others do who have no hope. Paul expects people to grieve. Paul makes it clear, you've got to grieve. I mean, even Jesus shows you that, because the Bible gives you a powerful image of Jesus dealing with grief. When his beloved friend Lazarus dies, and when that happens, Jesus doesn't just weep. The Bible tells you that he groans in grief. But not only that, Lazarus' death makes Jesus angry. He goes to the tomb, to borrow Homer's words, in angry grief. And if you have ever lost someone, you know about angry grief. And you can know if Jesus grieved like that, you can grieve like that too. But even as you grieve, you can grieve with hope. Why? You know, you can know that death does not have the last word. Jesus does. And if you know the story of Lazarus, you know that in that story, Jesus does have the last word. Jesus calls Lazarus out of the tomb, and Lazarus comes. Jesus defeats death for Lazarus. And in doing so, Jesus is only foreshadowing what is about to happen to him in just a few days. For in a few days, Jesus himself will die out of love for us. And out of that same love, Jesus will rise again. And let's make it clear, No one expected Jesus to rise from the dead. The Jews had an idea of resurrection of the dead, but it occurred at the end of time, not in the middle of time. There was no conception anywhere in the ancient world of resurrection in the here and the now. No one had that idea. The pagans didn't have that idea. The Jews didn't have that idea. And so when it actually happened, in the here and now, when Jesus rose, it changed everything. And Jesus did not rise like Lazarus did. I mean, after all, Lazarus did eventually die again. No, all the accounts of Jesus' resurrection make it clear that Jesus came back different. He was the same Jesus, but something had changed. See, Jesus had not simply defeated death. Jesus had defeated death once and for all, not simply for Jesus, but for everyone. After Jesus, death was done. And Jesus shows you that victory in reality. Jesus gives you a real resurrection, proof of concept, so to speak. See, when folks in early Christianity got killed for Jesus' resurrection, they didn't do it because of words that they had heard. They did it because of a reality they had seen. They had seen Jesus out of love die for them, and they had seen the same Jesus out of love defeat death for them. They had experienced the defeat of death. They had heard about it. They had seen it. And in that defeat of death, Jesus gives you a picture of what God's love brings for you, for everyone. Why you can grieve with hope. First, you can grieve in hope because Jesus died as Jesus. And he came back as Jesus. You know, some religious traditions have this idea of the afterlife is you're a drop and you fall into the ocean. But once you fall into the ocean, you're not a drop anymore. Right? You're just the ocean. The you that is you is now lost. But Jesus came back as Jesus. So you can know you will come back as you, that those you love will still be them when you see them again. And in that defeat of love, Jesus will give you life. Life as you've always sensed life is supposed to be. A life of love, a world abounding in love. I mean, think about the most wonderful moments you had in love, or about a great party, or a piece of music that rocked your world, or an amazing meal. Think for a moment about how you felt seeing this magnificent mountain scene, or experiencing a beautiful waterfall, or simply walking by the beauty of the ocean. And the gospel proclaims that is but a taste of the world of love that Jesus is bringing. And here in Paul's letter, God tells you that this world of infinite love isn't something up there somewhere. No, this world of infinite love is coming down here. Jesus doesn't want to snatch people up into heaven. Jesus is bringing heaven to earth. That is where this passage ends. You see, too often Christians have misread these words at the end as if Jesus is rapturing people up to heaven. But those who have died in Christ are only rising to join Jesus as Jesus comes down to earth. You see, the term Paul uses here is a very specific term. And it is only used of someone who is joining an entourage, the entourage of a king who is returning from victory, of a victorious king returning to bring a world full of love and free of death. So how do you deal with death? You don't deaden yourself to it. You don't try to rationalize it away. You don't deny its reality. Instead, you declare to death, death, you do not have the last word. Jesus does. And that love has defeated you now and forever. And when you know that love, when loss hits, yes, you grieve. But you grieve as those with hope. For you know death does not have the last word. Jesus does. The love of Jesus does. And in that confidence, you can work now to defeat death, to join with Jesus in bringing into reality this world of love. You can join with Jesus in giving everyone this hope, the promise of a world where love lives and death dies. Do you believe that Jesus died to defeat death for you? That Jesus rose again to do that? Do you believe that Jesus loves you like that? To death and beyond. If you don't, ask Jesus to show you. Just ask him. And he will. And if you believe it, then you can live in hope. You can live in hope no matter how far, hard, or difficult, or scary things get. As a famous actor once said, that in a world where the dead have come to life, the word trouble loses much of its meaning. And this world where the dead have come to life, that world exists. It is real. You can know because of that, that death does not have the last word. Jesus' love does. Always. So go forth and live in that hope. And when the time comes, die in that hope as well. For death does not have the last word. Jesus does. Amen.